Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture of the course heat transfer. So we are actually continuing the module convection heat transfer. So in the last lecture we have started this module, that is convection, and there we have discussed the objectives of this convection heat transfer. So this convection part, it is mainly related to the fluid mechanics concept. So that's why in the last lecture we have reviewed the basic concepts of the fluid mechanics. So today it is the continuation of the last lecture. So today we will study in details the boundary layer theory concept and various formulas regarding different thicknesses of this boundary layer theory. So there we will see what is the laminar boundary layer, what is turbulent boundary layer, so what is happening actually in case of the boundary layer, then different dimensionless parameter regarding this fluid mechanics, which are very much applicable to this heat transfer also. So all those dimensionless parameters and their physical significance also we will discuss in details today. So let us start this lecture. So today we'll start with the forced convection part, which is external flow over a flat plate. So this forced convection and natural convection or free convection, these are the classification of the convection mode of heat transfer which we have discussed earlier. Now an internal flow is surrounded by solid boundaries that can restrict the development of its boundary layer. For example, a pipe flow. So this is an example of the internal flow. But what happens in case of an external flow? An external flows are the flows over bodies immersed in an unbounded fluid, so that the flow boundary layer can grow freely in one direction. So what are the examples of this external flow? So the examples include the flows over aerofoils or airfoil and ship hulls, turbine blades, etc. So here in this diagram you can see an over a flat plate, free stream velocity of the fluid, it is flowing over the flat plate, and then the boundary layer thickness, it is gradually increasing in the x direction. Now the fluid particle adjacent to the solid surface is at rest. These particles act to retard the motion of adjoining layers, so that means which ultimately leads to the boundary layer effect. Now, inside the boundary layer we can apply the following conservation principles, which are the momentum balance with the inertia force, pressure gradient, viscous forces and body forces. So gravity force is one example of the body force. Next, the energy balance, where the convective flux, diffusive flux, heat generation, energy storage, etc. are applicable. So this is the difference in between the concept of the internal flow and external flow. So let us move to the next page. So today we'll study in details the concept of the boundary layer. So in fluid mechanics we have actually studied different dimensionless parameter, like the most important dimensionless number, it was the Reynolds number, so which is the ratio of inertia force divided by the viscous force. Now if the viscous force, it is very much low, in that case the Reynolds number, it will be very much high, right? Because the Reynolds number, it is the ratio of inertia force by viscous force. Now in this Reynolds number we can consider three different cases. Suppose first we are considering the viscous force term, it is very much high. Suppose this is our first case, the viscous force term, it is very much high. In that case the Reynolds number, it will be very much smaller. So this type of flow, it is known as the creep flow. When the viscous force is very high, that means it will lead to the value of the Reynolds number to be very small. So it is known as the creep flow. So this is our first case. Next, suppose the second case, when the viscous force, it is negligible or almost zero. So in that case, if there is no viscosity, then that type of flow, it will be known as ideal flow. Okay, so this is our second case. And suppose the third case, when the viscous force, it is very small but non-zero. So in that case, the Reynolds number, it will be very much high. So that type of flow, when the viscous force is very small but Reynolds number, it will be very much higher. That type of flow, it is known as the boundary layer flow. So from the concept of Reynolds number, we have considered, we have seen these three different cases. Okay. Now, what is this boundary layer actually? In this diagram, we can see that the boundary layer on a flat plate, it is given here. And laminar boundary layer, transition, turbulent boundary layer, different things are written in this diagram. So let us discuss this concept of boundary layer in details. So in the left side of this diagram, you can see different arrow signs are given and capital U is written here. So capital U, it is the free stream velocity of the fluid. So what happens? Suppose when a real fluid, so real fluid means there will be significant amount of viscosity. So when a real fluid, it flows past a solid body or a solid wall, then the fluid particles adhere to the boundary and condition of no slip occurs in that case. So what is this condition of no slip? It was discussed in the last class. So the adjacent surface of the fluid and the considered flat plate surface, there the relative velocity is almost negligible. So that part where the relative velocity is very much negligible, that is known as the no slip condition. Now the fluid particles adhere to the boundary of the solid wall and the condition of no slip occurs there. This means what? That the velocity of the fluid close to the boundary of this flat surface, it will be same as that of the boundary. So if the boundary, if it is static or stationary, then the velocity of the fluid at that boundary of the flat surface or flat plate, it will be zero. Now further away from this boundary, the velocity of the fluid, it will be higher, and as a result of this, the variation of velocity, that is the velocity gradient du dy, it will exist. This concept of this velocity gradient we have seen in case of Newton's viscosity or Newton's law of viscosity concept. So that means further away from the boundary of the flat plate, the velocity will be higher, and as a result of this velocity variation, there will be a velocity gradient. Now the velocity of the fluid increases from zero velocity on the stationary boundary, that means on the stationary flat plate, to the free stream velocity, that is capital U in the diagram you can see, of the fluid in the direction normal to the boundary. Now this variation of velocity from zero to free stream velocity in the direction normal to the boundary, so this takes place in a narrow region in the vicinity of the solid boundary of the flat plate. So this narrow region of the fluid, it is called the boundary layer. Okay? And the theory which deals with the boundary layer flow, it is called the boundary layer theory. So this is the main concept of the boundary layer theory. So and again we can say that boundary layer is the layer which divides the flow field in two different zones. One is the viscous zone and another is the non-viscous zone. Okay. Now a very thin layer of the fluid, which is called the boundary layer, in the immediate neighborhood of the solid boundary of the flat plate, which we consider, where the variation of the velocity from zero at the solid boundary to free stream velocity in the direction normal to the boundary takes place. So in this region of the boundary layer, the velocity gradient exists, and so the fluid in this region, it shows or it exerts a shear stress on the wall in the direction of the motion. Now, what is the velocity or value of the shear stress in this region? So it will obey the Newton's law of viscosity, that is tau equals to mu du dy, that means shear stress is proportional to the rate of shear strain. And what will happen in the remaining fluid? The remaining fluid which is outside the boundary layer. So this is the non-viscous zone. The velocity outside the boundary layer is constant and equal to the free stream velocity. So as there is no variation of the velocity in this region, that is outside the boundary layer, the velocity gradient du dy, it becomes zero then. And as a result of this, the shear stress, it is zero in the outside of the boundary layer. So this is the concept, that is inside the boundary layer, that is viscous zone, and outside the boundary layer, it is non-viscous zone. Now, in this diagram, we can see three different zones. Vertically, it is written. One is the first one is the laminar boundary layer, then the transition or unpredictable zone, and then the turbulent boundary layer. So the difference between laminar and turbulent flow we have discussed in the last lecture. So today we'll discuss what is the laminar boundary layer, what is the concept of the turbulent boundary layer, and in the turbulent boundary layer there are some other zones like the laminar sublayer, buffer layer, all these things will be discussed today in details. So let us first start with the laminar boundary layer or laminar boundary zone. So let us suppose consider the flow of a fluid which is having a free stream velocity over a smooth thin plate which or a flat plate which can be seen in this diagram, figure 1. So let us consider the flow with zero pressure gradient on one side of the plate which is stationary. So at the leading edge we have considered all these things. Now the velocity of the fluid on the surface of the plate, it should be equal to the velocity of the plate, because there the no slip condition is occurring, and as the velocity of the plate it is stationary, that means the adjacent liquid particles, it will also be static or stationary. But at a distance away from the plate, the fluid will have certain amount of velocity. Thus, a velocity gradient is set up in the fluid near the surface of the plate. This velocity gradient, it develops a shear resistance which retards the flow of the fluid. So the fluid with a uniform free stream velocity, it is retarded in the vicinity of the solid surface of the plate, and the boundary layer region begins at the sharp leading edge. So due to the difference of the velocity inside the boundary layer, a velocity gradient exists. So this velocity gradient exists, and this velocity gradient, due to the shear resistance, it retards the fluid. So due to this retardation, the boundary layer region of the flow, it starts beginning at the sharp leading edge of the plate. So at subsequent points downstream the leading edge, the boundary layer region increases because the retarded fluid particles are further retarded, so which will help in the growth of the boundary layer, which is actually a parabolic profile in case of the laminar boundary layer. Now near the leading edge of the surface of the plate, where the thickness is very small, the flow of the boundary layer, it is laminar, though the main flow it is turbulent. Now this layer of the fluid, it is said to be the laminar boundary layer. So this laminar boundary layer zone it is having a certain range of Reynolds number, which is up to 3.2 × 10⁵. So up to this value, the boundary layer zone, it is laminar. So it is the lower critical Reynolds number, up to which value the 3.2 × 10⁵, the boundary layer zone, it is laminar. Now from 3.2 × 10⁵ up to 5 × 10⁵, which is the upper critical Reynolds number, up to the in this region the boundary layer, it is transition or unpredictable, so it is neither laminar nor turbulent. So beyond this value 5 × 10⁵ of Reynolds number, the turbulent boundary layer starts increasing. The thickness of the turbulent boundary layer, it can be seen there. So what happens in the turbulent boundary layer zone, when the laminar boundary layer, it becomes unstable, and the motion of the fluid within this laminar boundary layer, it is disturbed, which is the characteristics of the turbulent boundary layer. In there, the flow, it is irregular, which leads to a transition from laminar to turbulent. Now this short length over which the boundary layer flow, it changes from laminar to turbulent, it is called as the transition zone. So in this transition zone, in this which can be seen the boundary layer profile, it is in zigzag form given in this diagram. So the velocity profile, it is unpredictable or uncertain in this transition zone. So further downstream of this transition zone, the boundary layer, it is totally turbulent, and the thickness of the boundary layer, it starts growing again. Now this layer of boundary layer, it is called the turbulent boundary layer zone. So beyond the transition zone, the turbulent boundary layer, it is same. Now here you can see that adjacent to the flat plate, in this diagram, adjacent to the flat plate, another layer, it is written, it is laminar sublayer, or it is also known as viscous sublayer. So this zone, it is actually seen in the turbulent boundary layer zone. So what is this laminar sublayer or viscous sublayer? So this region in the turbulent boundary layer zone, it is adjacent to the solid surface of the flat plate. So what happens in this zone, the velocity variation, it is influenced only by the viscous effects. So though the velocity distribution is a parabolic in nature in case of laminar boundary layer, which can be seen in this diagram, but as this laminar sublayer, it is having very small thickness, so that's why it is assumed that the velocity variation, it is straight line or linear in case of the laminar sublayer or viscous sublayer, and the velocity gradient, it is considered as constant in case of this laminar sublayer. So the shear stress in this laminar sublayer, it is constant, and it is equal to the boundary shear stress, which is tau naught. Now this, it is zoomed in this laminar, this laminar sublayer zone, and in this zoomed in diagram, we can see that above this laminar sublayer, another layer can be seen, and the name is buffer layer. So what is this buffer layer? So this buffer layer, it can be seen in this turbulent boundary layer zone. So what happens there, the transition or the drastically change from the laminar sublayer flow characteristic to the core turbulent characteristic, it does not happen suddenly. That means the fluid properties from the laminar sublayer to the core of the turbulent boundary layer, it means transition from the laminar to turbulent characteristics of the fluid, it does not happen suddenly. So there is another layer which is known as the buffer layer. So there gradually the fluid properties changes from its laminar characteristic to turbulent characteristic. and beyond this buffer layer, the fluid properties is a totally turbulent. So buffer layer, it is the transition zone where the fluid properties from the laminar sublayer to the turbulent characteristics, pure turbulent characteristics, it happens. So there the gradual changes happen from the laminar characteristics of the flow to the turbulent characteristics of the flow. So this is the concept of this boundary layer. So what are the velocity profile for these different zones of the boundary layer? So in case of the laminar boundary layer zone, the velocity profile, it is parabolic, which can be seen in this diagram. Then in case of transition zone, it is from upper critical Reynolds number to lower critical Reynolds number. In this transition zone, the velocity profile, it is uncertain, which can be represented here like a zigzag sign. Then in the turbulent boundary layer zone, the velocity profile, it obeys the log law. So, and in the laminar sublayer, the velocity profile, it is linear. So this is the concept of the boundary layer which we have discussed just now. Now in this boundary layer, there are four different thicknesses. So number one is boundary layer thickness, which is represented by delta. Number two is displacement thickness, which is represented by delta star. And the formula of this delta star, it is integration 0 to delta multiplied by 1 minus integration 0 to delta within bracket 1 minus small u by capital U into dy. Then momentum thickness, that is represented by theta. And the formula is integration 0 to delta small u by capital U into 1 minus small u by capital U dy. And energy thickness, delta suffix E, or in some book you can get it is as delta double star, which is integration 0 to delta small u by capital U into 1 minus small u square by capital U square into dy. So these are the formula of these different boundary layer thicknesses. So what is this boundary layer thickness delta? So it can be defined as the distance from the boundary of the solid body measured in the y direction, that is in the vertical direction, to the point where the velocity of the fluid, it is approximately equals to 99% of the free stream velocity. So this is the definition or the concept of the boundary layer thickness. In the similar manner, the other displacement, momentum and energy thickness also can be defined. Like in case of displacement thickness, we can write that it is defined as the distance, it is measured perpendicular to the boundary of the solid body by which the boundary should be displaced to compensate for the reduction in flow rate on account of boundary layer formation. So this distance perpendicular to the boundary by which the free stream is displaced due to the formation of boundary layer. So in this way you can also define the other momentum and energy thickness also. Now based on these equations for these different thicknesses, let us discuss one numerical. So what is given here? The velocity distribution in the boundary layer, it is given small u by capital U, it is y by delta. So delta is the boundary layer thickness. So where small u, it is the velocity at a distance y from the plate, and capital U is actually the free stream velocity of the fluid, and small u equals to capital U at y equals to delta. So one condition is given, being the boundary layer thickness. So we need to find the displacement thickness, the momentum thickness, the energy thickness, and the value delta star by theta. Now the velocity distribution which is given here, it is small u by capital U, this is equals to y by delta. So the displacement thickness, this is the first thing, delta star, that we need to find here. So the formula that we have seen in the earlier slide, that is delta star equals to 0 to delta integration 0 to delta 1 minus small u by capital U into dy. So the value of this small u by capital U, it is given y by delta, the velocity distribution. Now if you put this here and if you do this simple integration here, then after 2 or 3 step we will get the displacement thickness, that is delta star, this is equals to delta by 2. That is the displacement thickness, we are getting half of the boundary layer thickness. Next we need to find the value of the momentum thickness. So the formula of the momentum thickness, theta, this is equals to integration 0 to delta small u by capital U multiplied by 1 minus small u by capital U into dy. So if we put the value of small u by capital U, that is the velocity distribution, is equals to y by delta, then if we do the multiplication and after 2 or 3 step we do the integration, after 2 or 3 step we will get the value of the momentum thickness in terms of the boundary layer thickness, and which is 1/6 delta. So this is the value of the momentum thickness. Next we need to find the value of the energy thickness. Now this delta E or maybe delta double star in some other book. So the value of the delta E, that is energy thickness here, this can be calculated by using the formula, that is integration 0 to delta small u by capital U multiplied by 1 minus small u square by capital U square multiplied by dy. Now instead of small u by capital U, if you put the value of y by delta here, and first we need to do the multiplication, and after that if we do the integration and if we put the limit here 0 to delta, then after 2 or 3 step again we will get the value of this energy thickness. This is delta by 4, it is 1/4 of the boundary layer thickness. And the last, for the last part of this numerical, we need to find the delta star by theta. So as we have already calculated the value of this delta star and theta, so the ratio of this delta star and theta, it will be delta by 2 divided by delta by 6, that is ultimately we are getting ratio of delta star by theta, this is equals to 3. So in this numerical we need to only remember the formula of the displacement thickness, momentum thickness and energy thickness, and if you can remember all these three simple formula, then you can easily calculate by doing the integration for the desired things. So let us move to the next page. Now we will discuss different bound dimensionless number and their physical significance. So there are 7 different dimensionless numbers are here, and all their formula and physical significance, these are very much important in this course heat transfer. So let us start with the Reynolds number. So this is very much familiar to us, and we have studied this Reynolds number in the basics and the review of the fluid mechanics. So the Reynolds number, it is actually the ratio of inertia force by viscous force, and the formula is rho u L by mu. So in case of pipe, it is actually rho u D by mu, and this mu, it can be again represented as mu by rho, that is nu. It is, this dynamic viscosity can be represented also in kinematic viscosity. So in that case the Reynolds number, it can be written as ul by nu. So this Reynolds number, it signifies the relative predominance of the inertia to the viscous force occurring in the flow systems. The higher the value of the Reynolds number, the greater will be the relative contribution of the inertia effect. And the smaller the value of the Reynolds number, the greater will be the relative magnitude of the viscous stresses. Now, this Reynolds number, it is taken as an important criteria for dynamic and kinematic similarities in forced convection heat transfer. So, based on this Reynolds number concept, the viscous forces, these are higher or lower or absent. For the three different cases, what happens? What are the names of those flow, like free flow, ideal flow, and boundary layer flow? These are already discussed while we are discussing the concept of the boundary layer. So the next dimensionless term or dimensionless parameter, it is the Prandtl number. In short, it is PR. So it is the ratio of the kinematic viscosity, that is nu, divided by the thermal diffusivity, that is alpha. So the formula for the Prandtl number, it is mu Cp by K. So ultimately it can be again represented as kinematic viscosity by thermal diffusivity, which is nu by alpha. Now this kinematic viscosity, it indicates the impulse transport through molecular friction. And the thermal diffusivity, it indicates the heat energy transport by conduction process. Because the thermal diffusivity, we have studied that it is the ratio of the thermal conductivity to the heat capacity. Again, this Prandtl number, it provides a measure of the relative effectiveness of the momentum and energy transport by diffusion. These are the physical significance of the Prandtl number. So it is a connecting link between the velocity field and temperature field. And its value strongly influences relative growth of the velocity and thermal boundary layer. So this is the physical significance of the Prandtl number. So in this slide, what you have seen, that the Reynolds number, it is the ratio of inertia force and viscous force, and the Prandtl number, it is the ratio of kinematic viscosity to the thermal diffusivity. So next let us discuss the formula and the importance or the physical significance of the Nusselt number. It is Nu. So this Nusselt number, it is very much important in this course heat transfer. And in this convection module, the later classes or later lectures, we will see that for various geometrical shape and for its various condition and for natural convection or the forced convection, a number of equations regarding the Nusselt number you will get. And those different equations we need to remember to solve different numericals for this heat transfer, convection heat transfer. Now, the Nusselt number, it is the ratio of the heat flow rate by convection process under a unit temperature gradient to the heat flow rate by conduction process under a unit temperature gradient through a stationary thickness. That means the Nusselt number, it is Q convection by Q conduction, that is HL by K. So this formula, it is similar to the Biot number that we have got earlier in case of lumped parameter analysis. Now it is the ratio of heat transfer rate Q to the rate at which heat would be conducted within the fluid under a temperature gradient. So Nusselt number is Q by delta theta multiplied by L by K. Again, it can be defined as the ratio of the characteristic length L to the thickness delta X of a stationary fluid layer conducting the heat at the same rate under the same temperature difference as in the case of convection process. So these are the three different ways through which we can define the dimensionless number, that is Nusselt number. Now it is a convenient measure of the convective heat transfer coefficient. Now, for a given value of the Nusselt number, the convective heat transfer coefficient is directly proportional to the thermal conductivity of the fluid, and it is inversely proportional to the significant length parameter. So this is the physical significance of this Nusselt number. The formula is very much similar to the Biot number, but there is an important difference in between that two, the Nusselt number and the Biot number formula. Now this is another dimensionless term, which is Stanton number, ST. So it is the ratio of heat transfer coefficient to the flow of heat per unit temperature rise due to the velocity of the fluid. The Stanton number, it is equals to H by rho u Cp. So it can be again represented mathematically as the ratio of Nusselt number divided by Reynolds number into Prandtl number. Means the ratio of the Nusselt number and the product of Reynolds and Prandtl number. So this Stanton number, it can be used only in correlating forced convection data. So this is the formula of the Stanton number, which is represented in terms of Nusselt, Reynolds and Prandtl's number. Next we are getting the Packlet number, it is PE. It is the ratio of mass heat flow rate by convection to the flow rate by conduction under a unit temperature gradient and through a thickness L. So Packlet number, it is Q convection divided by Q conduction. So this ratio is similar to Nusselt number ratio. So here, putting this value of the Q convection and Q conduction, ultimately we are getting the Packlet number formula as LU divided by alpha. So this Packlet number, it can be again represented in terms of other dimensionless terms, that is Packlet number, this is equals to Reynolds number multiplied by Prandtl number. So next we are getting the Grates number, capital G. So this Grates number, it is actually for the heat flow of the fluid flowing through circular pipe. That means for an internal flow, this Grates number, it is applicable. So it is defined as the ratio of heat capacity of fluid flowing through the pipe per unit length of the pipe to the conductivity of the pipe. If we put this value of the Grates number, we will get its formula as MCP divided by LK. So this Grates number, it can be again represented in terms of other dimensionless term, that is G equals to pi by 4 to Reynolds number multiplied by Prandtl number into D by L. So D and L, these are the diameter and length of the considered pipe. Now this Grates number, it can be again represented as Packlet number multiplied by pi D by 4. So that means it is a product of the Packlet number and a constant. It's pi D by 4, it will have a constant value for a pipe. So the last dimensionless number that we are getting here, that is Grashof number. So this Grashof number, it is related with natural convection heat transfer. So it is defined as the ratio of the product of inertia force and buoyancy force to the square of the viscous force. It is this Grashof number, it is actually the ratio of inertia force and buoyancy force, multiplication of the inertia force and buoyancy force divided by viscous force square. Now if we put all the values of these three different forces, then after two or three steps we are getting the formula of the Grashof number. It is rho square beta g delta t L cube divided by mu square. So Grashof number for a free convection, it is similar to the significance of the Reynolds number for a forced convection. Free convection, it is usually suppressed at sufficiently small Grashof number, begins at some critical value of the Grashof number depending upon the arrangement, and then becomes more and more effective with increasing Grashof number. So today we have discussed seven different dimensionless terms like Reynolds number, Prandtl number, then Stanton number, Nusselt number, Packlet number, Grates number and Grashof number. So one more dimensionless term is here, that is Rayleigh number. So all these things again we will discuss, and there are different formula for the later lectures, and different equations regarding the Nusselt number we will get. So those equations for different geometrical shapes we need to remember to solve different numericals. So today we have discussed the forced convection for an external flow, and there we have seen the difference between internal and external flow. After that we have discussed in details the concept of the boundary layer, and we have started that discussion from the dimensionless term, that is Reynolds number. And for that Reynolds number we have considered three different cases, and there we have seen when the viscous term, it is very much small, that means the Reynolds number, it will be very much high. So that type of flow is known as the boundary layer flow. So the different zones of the boundary layer, which are laminar zone, then the transition zone and the turbulent boundary layer zone. All these things have been discussed in details, and in that turbulent boundary layer zone, again the laminar sublayer and the buffer zone, these zones which can be seen in case of the turbulent boundary layer zone, these things also have been discussed, and their velocity profiles, all these things have been discussed. Then different bound thicknesses of the boundary layer, like the boundary layer thickness, displacement thickness, energy thickness and momentum thickness, all these things and their related formula and one numerical based on the formula of these different thicknesses have been discussed. And in the last part in this discussion, we have seen the seven different dimensionless term and their physical significance. So in the next class, on the next lecture, different equations of this boundary layer we will study in details. So this is the end for this lecture.